We on? Good morning, everybody. If you could find your table and get seated, we'll be starting very shortly. It's great to see so many of you here bright and early on this Valentine's Day morning. Okay, if you weren't fully awake before now, I bet you are wide awake after that. Thank you, kids. Welcome to KSARC's 24th annual fundraising breakfast and the 2013 Be Loud breakfast. My name is Margo Myers, and I'll be your MC this morning, and I'm so happy to see so many familiar faces, and I also see a lot of new faces out in the audience this morning, so welcome. We're thrilled that you could be with us on this very special Valentine's Day edition of this breakfast. Now, if this is your first breakfast with KSARC, it's pretty obvious that these kids and KSARC and staff and all of you table captains out there know how to be loud. Before we get started, you really may have noticed that we have a theme, which is Be Loud. And we really think it fits the mission of KSARC, and here's why. KSARC's innovative and effective therapy program leads survivors to raise their voices and be loud. KSARC victim advocates empower survivors in court to stand up and be loud. KSARC rallies the community to be loud and join our prevention awareness efforts, really by challenging old beliefs of silence around sexual assaults. And finally, KSARC will be loud about the unmet need in the community. While we're here to celebrate KSARC's dramatic successes in the therapy and the legal advocacy and prevention, we also need to recognize how much more needs to be done. There's a lot more work to do, and a number of sexual assault cases go untreated and unprosecuted every year, which keeps us from our ultimate goal of ending sexual assault. So how do you get to be loud this morning? No, we're not going to give you the breakfast tins, so you can be loud that way. But you may have noticed the buttons on your table. If you look at your table, you'll see a little orange Be Loud button. So I invite each of you to put on that button right now. If you want to take your smartphone out, you can take a photo and you can tweet it or post it to your Facebook page or any other social media sites you choose. Or you can show the photo to at least one other person or show the pen to one other person today. Maybe a colleague at work or maybe someone else who was unable to attend the breakfast, and show the world that you're being loud about ending sexual assault. And it's really not just about wearing the button while you're in this room. We all know what it means. So I invite you to wear the button for the next 7 days, every day for one whole week. And we recognize that, yeah, you know, this kind of takes some guts. People are going to ask you, what's be loud? What does that mean? So only take the button if you wish to accept the challenge. Or you can take a couple extras if you have other people that you know would be willing to take on the challenge. It's going to generate comments and questions. It really will. And we want you to be able to share information about KSARC and the movement that is underway to end sexual assault. It's easy to talk about, have these conversations with others. I've done it in the past. I know that many of you have. And there's a card that we're sharing information about a single KSARC program that is easy to talk about with others, and it's called 100conversations.org. In the process, what you'll be doing when you take these little buttons is you'll be helping us to build awareness about KSARC and sexual assault. And we certainly appreciate the support. We really, really want your advocacy. And we're really hoping that you will commit to do this morning. So go out there and have those conversations and let us know how it goes. You can email back to KSARC and let us know how it goes. If you know a board member or a staff member, we want to hear how those conversations go. This is really your chance to be loud about sexual assault and putting an end to that. So I would like to take a moment to recognize two groups of people who are absolutely critical to the success of this breakfast. I obviously have not had enough coffee this morning, so please hold your applause till the end. First, the volunteer leadership that helped put this event together for the past several months. This is a huge undertaking every year. It really is, to get this many of you in the same room at 7:30 on a Valentine's Day morning. My goodness. The committee has really worked hard and put a great deal of effort into the program that you're going to experience today. There are four co-chairs this year, Dan Brady, Jesse Franklin, Sue Taylor, and Glenn Zakara, with significant leadership from the Board Development Committee member, Joe Malahan. So please, let's give them a round of applause. Next, I'd like to recognize the hard work of all the table captains who participated in the breakfast, both in person at this event, and there's also a lot of virtual tables out there, too. So many of you have been doing this for more than a decade. We appreciate your support and you rallying your troops to get them here this morning. So you'll see everyone's names listed in the program. But let's have a big round of applause for the table captains and the chairs. They do great work. Now, we're also fortunate enough to have the support of corporate leaders who partner with us to make our community, you know, really the safe and vibrant place that it is. And as a private nonprofit agency, KSARC depends in part on corporate support to provide services free of charge to victims. So together, all of this year's sponsors have contributed an astounding $115,000. That's awesome. We appreciate that so much. And the complete list of sponsors is included in the printed program, and we would like to take a moment now to highlight our top-level partners. So please hold your applause until the end. Let's start with our premier sponsor, Expeditors International, We appreciate their longstanding support. Our visionary sponsors, the Archdiocese of Seattle and Schrader Goldmark and Bender. Also our champion sponsor, Quality Business Systems. And to the advocate and partner sponsors you see listed here as well as in the program, thank you, all of you, for your support. And they deserve a round of applause. Now, every gift to KSARC is greatly appreciated and valued, and we are really fortunate to have many longstanding and very generous donors. Remember, it's these individual contributions that really allow KSARC to provide services at no cost to the client. That's really important, no cost to the client. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize a special group of supporters. KSARC calls them major donors, and all of them make annual contributions of $1,000 and more. And over the years, this group has grown from just a few people, to 135 people. That's just so cool. It includes KSARC staff, current and past KSARC board members, past clients, and people just like you. But 135 people who donate $1,000 a year. So the major donors from 2012 are listed in your program. And those of you who are here today, you also have hearts on your name tags. So if you see someone with a heart on their name tag, say thank you. And if you have a heart on your name tag, we thank you. So everybody, join me in thanking these people for their wonderful, longstanding contributions. So there are hundreds of elected officials and other dignitaries at the city, county, and some state level who really work to serve our community and represent us. And KSARC depends on their advocacy on public policy legislation and funding issues, and the agency is proud to enjoy the support of so many of our key leaders in this region. A number of them have taken their time to join us this morning to show their commitment to being loud about ending sexual assault. And I want to recognize in particular that First Lady Trudy Inslee is here this morning, so welcome. And we have listed the names of the other dignitaries who are here among us this morning, joining us there in the program. And I would like you to join me in thanking them for all they do to help KSARC. And now I'd like to introduce KSARC's Executive Director, Mary Ellen Stone. She does a fabulous job, and we would like to hear a few words from her this morning. Mary Ellen?
Good morning. See, and I've got my speech up here without my specs. I'm thinking I can pull this off. This is always the best seat in the house to stand up here and to see this room full to capacity. So I want to say thank you. Oh, thank you, Margot. Okay. It's a statement, isn't it? We've been doing this a long time. But so I do have a couple things that I wanted to share with you this morning. You know, those of you who have been to the breakfast in the past, you're thinking, what's this Be Loud thing? Are we still doing kids are our business? We are. You saw the kids. This is very much a program that focuses on children and teens and all the issues for them around sexual assault. What's different now, obviously, is that we've got this tagline, Be Loud. And we are going to be loud about sexual assault in a way that we have not been before. We're going to certainly continue to focus on the stories of victims, the reasons that people come to us for help every day, but we're going to be even louder about the accomplishments that we see. We see very inspiring accomplishments every single day in our offices. Boys and girls, women and men, are able to turn their lives around because of the work that they do with us. And you're going to hear from some of those people this morning. And I tell you, 2012 has been quite a year for KSARC. We reached over 7,000 people with prevention tools that give people real concrete ways of reducing the risk of sexual assault. We increased the number of people who are getting therapy from us by 22%. This is huge for us. And I think even more importantly, 90% of the people who get help from us get better. That's a fabulous outcome that we are very, very proud of. Thank you. And that's a tribute to our staff, who are extraordinarily skilled and who I'm very proud to be working with. Our resource line, our 24-hour resource line, responded to over 2,500 calls from people needing help and information. And our legal advocates, the people who work through the criminal justice system, helped over 1,400 children, teens, and adults navigate all aspects of that process. And I think, interestingly, and we'll get you more information about this as this rolls out later this year, we're doing a study now that shows real significant results of the legal advocacy positively helping victims cope. We always knew this was the case. Now we have studies to start backing that up. But, you know, so I think about last year, and of all the successes and all the learnings we've had, the thing that stands out for me, and it's real basic, and it's fundamental, is that it's all of us that are making these changes. And the way we're going to change sexual assault in the long run is that we've got to get back to the fundamentals. We know that child and teen sexual assault in particular thrives on a lack of knowledge, of shame, of secrecy. You know, when a kid can't talk about their body, when a child doesn't feel like they can tell their parent about a concern, if they feel like it's going to be their fault, that they'll get in trouble, it really prevents them from raising any sort of questions. If we can blunt the offender's ability to use these tactics to manipulate our kids, we're going to reduce the rate of child sexual assault. Last year, at last year's breakfast, you may remember we had a video clip, because it was early in the morning and these were teenagers, we had a video clip from the kids who were in the Power of Prevention group. You remember that? A lot of kids saying, you know, we're doing this, and we pulled these kids together to help us come up with a program to help them be safe online. What we found is that actually they're pretty savvy about being safe online, but what they told us really still sticks with me. They said, you know, what we really need to be safe is that we need good information about some basic stuff like dating, like consent, like healthy boundaries, like how do I have a good relationship with somebody that I'm interested in. And they wanted to, and this is where we as adults go, they want to talk about that with us. They don't want to go online and read it. That's part of the problem. They want to talk about that with us. They want to talk about that with us in real time. And that's where we came up with 100 conversations. So you got that on your little card that I meant to bring up with me. But that, you got that on your card with your Be Loud pin. Thank you. And that is for us. That's for us as adults. That's not for the kids. That's those kids' words saying, here are the things we want to talk about with you. And we know that that's going to help them, because what all the research backs up the idea that if kids have good, solid relationships with the adults in their lives, if they've got relationships with people they can ask for, you know, ask questions, express their worries, share their fears, help figure these things out, then these kids are at much less risk for a variety of bad things, sexual assault included. So we created the 100 Conversations, and as Margot was saying, we want to challenge you to start using this with the young people in your life. This does require us to sort of maybe get a little courage of ourselves, because we may really want to think that somebody else is going to do this, but this is our job. And for those of you with younger children in your lives, on your tables we have a He Told Me Not to Tell. Now back in 1980, so this was the dark ages for sexual assault. Really, trust me, I was there. I remember. It was terrible. We pioneered, though, KSARC pioneered a very radical concept, and the idea was that we could talk about child sexual assault in a way that didn't scare everybody, that we could do that to reduce fear and to empower parents and their children. We wrote the first guide, the first guide in the country, it's the first guide ever in the world, that really helps parents talk about this with their children. We've had, that was 1980, we've had a bunch of editions since that time, millions of copies around the world, 10 different languages. But when we were thinking about the Be Loud Breakfast last fall, we realized this merits its own special edition. So there's a new edition of He Told Me Not to Tell on your tables. If for some reason you don't have one, we will get you one. And if you need more copies, you can download it from our website. But here's what's important. This is going to help us reduce sexual assault. We can talk about prevention. When I tell you every year child sexual assault has been reduced by 38% in 15 years, we can all go, that's great. Well, what's going to drive that up to 100%, because 38% is not 100%, and no one would accept 38% in your business of anything. To get it to 100%, it means that we are going to be doing this work. April is Sexual Assault Awareness Month. Look for us for some conversation starters. You've already got 100 conversations. We want to hear how that's working for you and your kids. You've got a He Told Me Not to Tell. We want to hear how that might be working. The Be Loud button is a grand way to start those conversations, and we want to hear from you how that's working as well. So Be Loud conversations. But Be Loud, the other thing with Be Loud, and Margot touched on this, is that we want to say, you know, we want to make sure that victims and their families get the treatment they need and the advocacy they deserve. That's also part of being loud. We've increased therapy numbers, but the one of the problems is we're still turning away too many people. 30 to 40% of the victims who would like to see us for therapy can't get in. And that's not because we don't know what to do, it's because we don't have enough therapists. In this town, that's not acceptable. We can do a whole lot better than that. And we're gonna be loud that that's a problem. Being loud also means that we want to support innovation. We want to say, there's some innovative programs that are working. We know they are. Let's showcase them. For example, we have this great program working with young people who are homeless, who've been sexually assaulted, who are at high risk of being trafficked into the whole commercial sexual exploitation world of young people. We're doing therapy with them in partnership with Youth Care. Fabulous program, great outcomes, nobody else is doing it. And we're seeing 20% of the need. That's completely unacceptable. We should be able to do a whole lot better than that, and we're going to be loud about that big gap. Being loud is also saying we need more prevention programming, whether that's in our schools, whether that's in our neighborhoods, our faith communities, we all need to be pushing for prevention programming. We're working with our friends at Committee for Children to support some legislation that would strongly encourage schools to have some better prevention programming. But this is something that we all can do. So, you know, I'm gonna be loud with you, with our supporters, about the accomplishments that we've achieved over the last, 37 years for this organization, but the last year. But I also wanna be real clear with all of us that this is our collective job. We as citizens, we as people who live here, who have families here, who have friends here, we can drive this number from 38% reduction up to 100%, but it means all of us starting to be loud in whatever way works for you, but to be loud. So, this morning, you're gonna hear stories, because that's one of the things that moves us. You'll hear stories of hope, you'll hear people with remarkable accomplishments, and you're going to hear about lives that really have been turned around. You know, KSARC is always going to remember where we've come from. We will never forget the incidences, the assaults, the trauma that have brought people to our door, that bring us, you know, bring people here to us in the first place. And I don't mean to sound Pollyanna about this, but you know, our lives are really terrific. We are extraordinarily blessed. And we want to help people also think about the positive and keep us looking forward. You know, the saying is that the windshield is always bigger in the car than the rearview mirror because you're looking forward and not backwards. And I think that there's a lot of truth in that. We want all of us to live our lives in the present with looking for the future and not be burdened by the past. And that's one of the things that we help victims do, is to unshackle themselves from that past, to put it in its place, to look forward to the future with a lot of hope and a lot of promise. So as we think about the Be Loud piece, I want you to also, I ask you to think about KSARC in maybe a little bit different light. I mean, we are the same organization that you have known and supported and stood with us on, and I'm profoundly grateful for that. But think, too, about us as maybe being an organization that rebuilds hope in people's lives, that helps people look forward to the future with more optimism, that we rebuild people's lives, and know that we're always going to be really loud about this, about sexual assault, our agency, and our future, because that's what we're all doing together. And on that, thank you so very much.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. And it's so great to hear that progress is being made. We love to hear that message every year. But then when we hear there is so much unmet need, we can do more. And I know that we will. Not everything about Be Loud has to be about making noise. Sometimes the loudest thing you can do is to be quiet, to be present in your support. So if someone you know, someone you love, has been affected by sexual assault, will you please join me in standing up for them right now? We want to honor them, and we want them to know that you're not alone. And this simple act, it gets me every year. Those of you who know me know I also cry at Olympic commercials. This simple act of commitment, you know, and shows your support, that you stand with them. And I think that is so important. Look around the room. Look how many of you are standing. All of you know someone or are someone who has been touched by sexual assault. That's just amazing. And the support in this room, there are more than 800 of us here this morning. So please take a moment and look around. We are all connected in that way. Huge amount of support here. So thank you for standing and showing your support and commitment. When you stand up here and you look out over the room, even in these glasses that make you a little blurry, it's amazing to see how many people are standing up. It's just, I love that level of support. So now we want to hear from someone who used KSARC to really springboard forward and vault into an amazing future. It's my pleasure to introduce Lexi this morning. She is just a spirited young woman who came to KSARC for legal advocacy, for their support. She left stronger and more capable and ready to tackle just about anything. Please welcome Lexi.
Okay, that was kind of an emotional introduction. Oh my goodness, I'm already tearing up. Good morning, all of you. Thank you for having me today. I feel very blessed and honored to share my story with all of you. Being a sexually assaulted victim are some difficult shoes to walk in, but I chose to see them as strong, ambitious, and driven ones. I'm not ashamed to share with all of you that I am a sexually assaulted victim. In a way, it's definitely influenced who I am today. But one would think that the torment and the abuse would drive anyone to sadness, insecurities, loss of faith, hopelessness, unlovable, estranged, and even just plain weird. But when I was asked to speak at today's event, I was ecstatic. I was thrilled. I was actually honored that I would have the opportunity to voice with all of you what had happened to me and how I can help. Growing up, I had a tough family situation, so I ended up living with my aunt and uncle. I'm just gonna lay it on you guys. I was raped every single day for 5 years straight by that uncle. Just me and my lonesome to endure the abuse. From age 9, the age in everyone's life with not a care in the world, to the confusing hormonal age of 14, every single day by myself for 5 years. I told no one. I talked about how unhappy I was with the living arrangements, but not the rapes. I began to reach out to my Aunt Crescentia and eventually moved in with her family. I now have a new dad, my Uncle Bob, my new mom, Crescentia, and my new siblings, Austin, Jordan, and Jessica. I love the new life. My mom was my savior. It took time and, trust me, a lot of tears, but I loved it. My life was everything I had dreamt of. So for 4 years, I kept what happened to me inside. No one needed to know what happened. Why? Why tell a single soul? Why rock the boat when what I have now is better than anything I've ever imagined? I'm free. I was finally given the life and freedom from him, so why tell a soul? Until one day, my senior year in high school, I'm just getting home from work, and it hits me. My baby sister Jessica hasn't been home all weekend. With a family that's active in sports, extracurricular activities, and myself with work, one can get lost in the chaos of a huge family. So I ask her, Jessie, where have you been all weekend? I haven't seen you at all. She replied so nonchalantly, oh, I was at auntie and uncle's house playing with our cousin. At that moment, my heart dropped. My body got chills. How can I allow my baby sister to go to that sick man's house and stay the night all weekend? Is he sexually assaulting her too? Shortly after hearing the disturbing news from Jessie, I broke silence and told my mom what my uncle was doing to me. From there, she held my hand as we started this year-long process through something you never prepare for. At that moment, I had no idea how intense the next year was going to be. I remember all those meetings and interviews as if they were yesterday. Throughout the criminal justice process, I had my go-to girl, Gemma, though, my victim's advocate from KSART. I remember what it was like to have my advocate with me at all times. Every time we went to Kent to talk to the defense attorney, to be interviewed, to be interrogated, she was always there. She was soft, she was gentle. Walking into a courthouse, you see suits and briefcases, and being a 19-year-old who's never even been pulled over, to be in an environment like that's, it's, you know, it's uncomfortable. They don't prepare you for that. But Gemma, even just the way her body language, her demeanor, she wasn't there to, yes, I'm an advocate. She was there for my comfort. And it's kind of funny because I didn't even know I needed it until after the fact. At one point, my mom, Crescentia, and I talked a lot with about fashion, about, you know, her hair, I like your boots. She was just very personable. And when you're dealing with something that's so intense and, you know, something that you don't want to discuss, you need to have that, you know, you're okay, you're on my side, I don't have to watch what I say to you, you're there for me in particular, not just to clock in. Whether it be via text, call, or email, she let me know what was going on and what was going to come up next. I remember trial like it was yesterday, a blistering cold week filled with nothing but interrogation, misleading questions, and disturbing stories. But when they first told me I was going to trial January 10th, 2012, I really didn't know what that meant. In my head, I'm thinking, Law and Order, SVU, get ready. I have no idea. But when Gemma had explained it to me, there was no sugarcoating. She prepared me and let me know to be ready to be in the hot seat. Get ready to have the defense attorney make you look like you're in the wrong, but stand up for the truth and you'll be fine. I was on the witness stand at trial for 9 hours and had to explain the assaults of 5 years in front of my entire family and a jury of 12 strangers. It was extremely difficult. But thank the Lord, my prosecuting attorney, Nicole Weston, was there. I cannot express to you, Nicole, how wonderful you did and how you stood up for me. Thank you so much. As I would go into detail on the assaults, I would see my dad cry. I saw my aunties cry. My best friend cried. My boyfriend glared at my uncle with hate and disgust. I saw the look on my entire family's face as I told what was done to me. What does my family think of me now? Will they treat me different? I was strong, though. The only point where I ever fell weak into tears was losing the relationship with my Aunt Cecile. I had to realize I wasn't alone, though. Life doesn't prepare you for police reports, but KSARC does. Life doesn't prepare you for interviews, interrogations, but KSARC does. Life doesn't prepare you for trial, but KSARC does. If you're not ready for meetings with investigators, KSARC is with you. I remember after one of my many days of interviews with my legal advocate, she had pulled me aside to tell me how proud she was of me. She told me that most sexually assaulted victims can't even build up enough strength and courage to continue on with the case, let alone sit on the stand in trial in front of jurors and loved ones and explain what had happened. From that point on, those words of encouragement didn't just push me to have an extra push for my voice, for myself, but for those who couldn't be loud. To my family and loved ones, it had been shocking to sit there through trial and listen to every detail that had happened to me. I was 19 years old when my uncle went to trial. I had been dealing with it by myself alone for 10 years, and I couldn't wait. I couldn't wait to scream. I couldn't wait to be loud. I couldn't wait to voice what had happened to me. Today's event is to encourage the voice of sexually assaulted victims to be loud. It happened to my nieces, my aunt's niece, my baby sister's big sister, my grandma's granddaughter, me, right here, being loud. I love who I am today. I love who I'm becoming. When this entire court case was brought up, I wasn't ready for what epiphany would actually hit me. I've always wanted to do so much in my life. Kind of confused. What am I going to do when I grow older? Why am I here? What's my passion? I would never truly know exactly what I was meant to do. It hit me one day after my uncle was sentenced to 13 years that I have the voice. I knew I was here for something. Everybody's, right? The assaults didn't make me weak. The assaults gave me a voice to be loud, and that gave me purpose. You might think it's corny, but I think it's quite appropriate because I was approached to speak at today's event, and I was honestly flattered. I want to do this right here from day one. Speak what happened to me. Be a voice for those who can't. Help others. Use my intellect and my case to show that you can do anything and get past it all. I love that I'll never settle for anything less than happiness. I love that every day I wake up knowing that no matter what the world has to bring to me, I've gone through some stuff, and I know I can conquer anything. I love that every day I wake up knowing that no matter what happens in my future, I know that I will conquer anything. I'm actually hoping that at the end of today's event, more doors will open for me and give me an opportunity to be loud, to end the silence, to help others. I'm not gonna lie, the process was difficult, but because I chose to be loud and with KSARC, I know I'm going to be a strong woman for the rest of my life. And I'm able to do that because of all of you in this building supporting the cause. Thank you. Thank you very much, and happy Valentine's Day. Thank you. Thank you.
Lexi, don't go too far. It's such a brave thing that Lexi has done here today, coming up and sharing her story. And, you know, it's clear you have tremendous courage and will go far. And I'm really proud of you today. And I want to share something with you. Another client recently told me, she said, you know, being here in this breakfast with 800 other people, it's like being embraced in a big hug. There's so much love in the room. And so I hope that you feel that today. I really do. You were alone, but we're all here together today, and we appreciate you sharing your story. Okay, we are going to shift gears just a little bit. Normally showing a video at this hour of the morning, might put those of you who are still waking up back to sleep, but I'm pretty sure that's not going to happen when you see this video. Remember, we're here at the Be Loud Breakfast, and this year's video is a little different than the videos that you've seen in the past. A big part of what KSARC does, and Mary Ellen talked about this, is to help adults and kids have conversations about safety, especially in the context of sexual assault. So the kids you're going to see in this video, they're not actors. They're board members' kids, they're staff members' kids, and they're very brave kids. When KSARC talks about prevention, this is what it looks like. And you're gonna see it when you read the He Told Me Not to Tell, the new edition of that, and hear it directly from these kids. It is absolutely critical to have these conversations. You wanna make sure you have them in the language that works for you and your family, what you're comfortable with. But it's something that we can all do. We can all do this. And it's for all the kids in our lives.
Hi, parents. Listen up. I'm going to teach you something.
I know I'm just a kid, but this is a serious subject, so listen up.
First of all, parents, there's something that you need to know.
Certain areas of my body are private.
Certain areas of my body are private, and it's not okay for anybody to touch them.
It's not okay for anyone to touch my vagina.
It's okay to talk about your body parts and call them their real names.
V-A-G-I-N-A.
And only I can touch it.
I have a head, eyes.
Or my mom.
Nose, mouth, chin. Arms, penis.
P-E-N-I-S.
Girls have a vagina and boys have a penis.
If you don't know what a penis or a vagina is, ask your mom.
Kids need to have good information about their bodies, and that's where you parents come in.
Girls have a vagina, boys have a penis.
And everyone has a butt.
And I assume everybody knows where their butt is.
You might feel a little awkward, but kids like me are totally open to it.
This isn't something to laugh about. It's important. And the more you talk about it, the easier it is.
The more you do it, the easier it is.
Talking about these things is not a one-time thing. It's something you do your whole life.
Parents and kids need to talk to each other a lot.
It's really important for parents to talk to their kids their whole lives.
We kids understand a lot, but we need some help too.
Kids need to know a lot of safety rules, and touching rules are just some of them.
And there are different kinds of touch.
There's three kinds of touches: okay touches, not okay touches, and confusing touches.
There's okay touch, not okay touch, and confusing touch.
This is called education, and it helps stop bad behavior.
It's okay touch if my mom kisses me goodnight. It's not okay touch if the man next door kisses me. Sometimes I see my little sister's vagina, but it would be weird if a babysitter showed me hers.
I can see my sister naked, but I don't want to see a lot of ladies naked.
One of the most important things is for kids to tell if someone tries to touch their private parts.
Kids need to know that if someone touches them, they can tell their mom.
Secrets are never good. This goes for grown-ups too.
It's important for kids to know if someone does touch them, it's never their fault.
It's your fault if you don't clean your room. It's never your fault if somebody touches your private parts.
It's not just about someone touching a kid.
It's never the kid's fault.
No one should ask the kid to touch them.
This is called education, and if we communicate more, we can all do a lot to stop sexual abuse.
So now, parents, if we kids can do it, you guys can.
Don't just wait for us to tell. It's good to ask questions, too.
Now it's up to you guys. You think we can do it?
The world isn't perfect, but we can make it better.
We can.
So I'll see you later. We have some work to do.
Even though the kids in this video aren't in the room this morning, I appreciate the round of applause for them because that took some bravery. And as the kids said, hey, this is education. We've all been educated now this morning. And those conversations are difficult to have, but we can do this. They're important conversations to have. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Sue Taylor. She is the program co-chair for this morning's Be Loud Breakfast. Dr. Taylor attended Gonzaga University and graduated magna cum laude in chemistry before attending the UW School of Medicine. She completed an internship in psychiatry and then did a residency in internal medicine at University of California, San Diego. After working at Group Health in a number of roles, including urgent care chief and district medical director, she'll be starting a fellowship in palliative medicine at the University of Washington. Dr. Taylor received the Volunteer of the Year Award from Meredith Matthews East Madison YMCA and also the Distinguished Alumni Merit Award from Gonzaga University. Please welcome Dr. Sue Taylor. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome and thank you. My story this morning has two heroes. One is from the past, and the other is in this room, and you're gonna have to listen carefully to figure out who it is. Last year, the video featured a young woman named Kanisha. She narrated her story about how KSARC had helped her. What was interesting in the story was the presence of a little girl. In each scene, she was silently standing by, and it was clearly her younger self. In the final scene, she's sitting on a couch, and she's finishing the story, and she's healing. And suddenly, she grabs her keys, and she jumps up. She gets in her car, and she's going down this road, and the wind is blowing. They're down trees. She's going along this river, and in the distance, you can see that little girl again, and she's just standing there in this thin coat, in this thin dress, and she's not wearing a coat. And Kanisha slams on the, and she jumps out of the car, and she rushes over to that little girl, and she puts her arms around her. And the message and the mission of KSARC, because everyone deserves a chance to heal. And Toni Morrison's first book, The Bluest Eye, was about a little girl that was victimized also by her father. It was a powerful book. But Morrison said years later that that book didn't have the effect that she had hoped for. It really didn't change things. People were touched, but they weren't moved. But Kanisha's story and the mission of KSARC moved me. Because you see, there was a 12-year-old girl I left behind a lot of years ago in Bonners Ferry, Idaho. I left her standing all alone. And the winters there are long and cold. I had the chance to go to college and to medical school, but she didn't. I didn't like to think what had happened to her, so I didn't. But that breakfast and that message got to me. So after the breakfast last year, I called Deanne Yamamoto, and I joined the Adult Survivors Group. And we spent 13 wonderful and hard weeks going back in time and learning how to put our arms around that little girl. We allowed ourselves to remember, how to tell our stories. We learned how to find the good in ourselves. We learned how to trust. We learned how to grieve. And finally, unbelievably, how to find joy. At the end, we had this amazing party. We had sushi, we had chocolate. We had a soundtrack of our favorite Guilty Pleasures music. We listened to Wilson Phillips and Journey and my personal new favorite, Justin Bieber. So to every child who has survived sexual assault, you are my hero. I'm so proud of you. You went through such a tough time. There was no one there to protect you. You were trapped. You did what you had to do, and thankfully you did. You amaze all of us. We know your goodness, your innocence, and your beauty. To all the boys that were deceived and lied to, and manipulated by Jerry Sandusky. You are our heroes. He did the wrong thing. You did the right thing. We stand by you. Which brings me to my second hero. All of you in this room, on Valentine's Day, man, you are here. You're so beautiful, and you mean a lot to me. When I came to this breakfast for the first time, maybe, just maybe, I was expecting, you know, a few dozen social workers in some agency basement. But wow, look at you guys. You take my breath away. And in truth, I couldn't have done it without you. That first Wednesday night, we were driving. I was supposed to be in Renton. I went to Kent. I was so stressed out. I got lost. I was driving around and finally got on the I-5 ramp heading back home. And I had this vision of all of you. And I had this overwhelming sense that you wanted me better. And I pulled off and I pushed everything off the passenger seat of my car. And I took the hand of my little 12-year-old self and I said, Susie, there are 900 people at the Westin, and they believe you and they want you better. And we're going to get through this thing, and we're going to come through that door next year. And you know, it worked. I got out my phone and I dialed the numbers, and I got there. Brené Brown is a sociologist who studies connection. You know, it's why we're here. It's what gives our lives purpose and meaning. But when she studies connection, all people want to talk about is disconnection, about being hurt, because we all have fears of being excluded, that somehow we won't belong. You know, it's universal. Is there something about me that keeps others from liking me? Am I thin enough, successful enough, tall enough? You know the drill. And what underpins that is excruciating vulnerability. For survivors, it's even worse, right? We keep ourselves walled off with shame and silence. But on the other hand, she's found that connected people, fully connected people, she calls them the wholehearted. They have a strong sense of worthiness and belonging. They fully embrace their stories, their faults, with compassion for themselves. Because that thing, whatever it is, that makes you the most vulnerable, that's the birthplace of what makes you the most lovable, the birthplace of your beauty. Because if you can reveal yourself, your true self, others naturally reach out. And you're the ones that make it possible for survivors to be authentic. You make it achievable for us to tell our stories. Incredibly, we feel normal. For the first time in our lives, we feel love and acceptance. In just my group, we had someone who had to drop out of Dartmouth. She's back now. She's in her classes. We have someone who's in her first year of her master's in family and marital counseling. We have another who's in her second year of nursing school. I see her on Facebook all the time. She's so happy. What the people in this room do is spiritual. It is profound. I believe we're here to be connected. Because when we're connected in this life, humanity happens. God happens. We serve each other best when we do what we love for the greatest cause we can imagine. Each other. So, to the hundreds of KSARC donors who make thousands of lives possible, fulfilled lives possible, thank you. You made the decision that what we had been through was too much. So you paid the bill. You took on that responsibility. You thought that was fair. It truly humbles me, what you did for me, a complete stranger. I'm so grateful. And I want you to think about that the next time you interview somebody from the Ivy League or get exceptional care from a nurse or a therapist. Or maybe you just pull up next to me at a stop sign and you get to listen to me sing along to Justin Bieber. You made that possible. Because of you, we're winning. And I want to close with this. Sports Illustrated had on its cover the year's most inspiring performers. Eli Manning, Serena Williams, Jeremy Lin. and R.A. Dickey and Kayla Harrison. He won the Cy Young Award, played for the Mariners, and she got the Olympic judo gold. Each one of them came forward this year with their own stories of childhood sexual assault and healing. Hundreds of young athletes are coming forward. And we want to be ready for them. We want to be able to say, yeah, that's right. We weren't there when it happened. You were all alone. But you are never going to be alone again. We are right here. You will not fall down. Your world has a floor, it has walls, and a door. You're going to walk through that door. We're waiting right here. Here there is kindness. Here there is compassion. Here there is safety. So, the story has two heroes. One is from the past, every child who has inspired us with their courage. Each of us has our own. You know who yours is. And the heroes in this room who have created a better, more connected world. There are so many places you could be here this morning. Something brought you here, something bigger than yourselves. I want you to give. I want you to give so much that you amaze yourselves. I want you to give so much you amaze your accountant. Give for the heroes in your past. Give for the ones in your heart. But mostly, give because of who you are. Thank you so very much.
Sue was our hero this morning, Sue and Lexi, don't you think? So this is the time when we ask our table captains to open those white envelopes at your table and distribute the pledge cards. And we thank you for your contributions. You know, those eye-popping ones, they're going to shock your accountants. Because they really are critical to KSARC's ability to continue to be on the front line with victims and their families. Think of the people you are helping, people you may never know, or people like Sue, who rock out to Justin Bieber. So we thank you this morning for coming. We thank you for your support. We thank you for everything that you're doing. We thank you for being loud. We thank you for having those conversations with your kids, with your neighbors, with your colleagues. We thank you for all of that. So just a couple of housekeeping things. Table captains, if you will bring your pledge envelopes to the foyer on your way out. And we want all of you to have a great day. We want you to wear your Be Loud buttons. And thank you for spreading the word about the King County Sexual Assault Resource Center. We can do better, and we will do better. And we wish all of you a great Valentine's Day. Have a great day. And we will see you here next year.